Tonight here on RaceSpot TV, we bring you the Checkered Flag Racing League 24designs.com night race at Bristol Motor Speedway in memory of Steve Byrnes. Coverage will start next here on RaceSpot TV, your home of some of the biggest sim racing events in the world. Cars are lined up on the grid. The RaceSpot.com World Championship Grand Prix Series. We are underway. They all come down in turn one for the first time. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to RaceSpot TV for the Checkered Flag Racing League 24designs.com night race at Bristol Motor Speedway in memory of Steve Byrnes. Will Vincent along with Rachel Whiteford qualifying is currently underway here at Bristol Motor Speedway, known as the Last Great Coliseum. It's a racetrack that measures just a tad over half a mile and plays host to some of the most exciting racing that you will see all NASCAR season. It hosts two races a year, the first one in spring, the second is of course the Irwin Tools Night Race, which is kind of what we're replicating here today on RaceSpot TV. As you see, drivers are still working themselves on qualifying, open qualifying as per NASCAR rules in 2015, as you can see there. Well, so there's a couple of drivers on the racetrack right now, and left hand side of your screen, you'll see the qualifying times. It is currently the 15.920, the pace, which is 41,000 of a second, separating P1, P2, and it is this driver who we can ride along board with now, the driver of Nate Lacomi in the Club Florida 01 car, who is fastest in qualifying. He's just pulled himself off the racetrack. You got yourself Clint Carr in the Club Plains car, currently scored in second place, Rachel, just 4/1000ths of a second back.
Yes, they are indeed, and wow, it's a close qualifying so far, of course, with the top six drivers within the 15.9 bracket, of course, stretching from that 15.919 up to a 15.947, so half a tenth covering top six places. This is going to be a tight one tonight, Will.
Yeah, we're right on board with the number 88 machine of William Kuziska there in the Club New York Red Bull cars. They had themselves then down the back straightaway, as you can see him coming now into turn number 3 and 4. Now, banking has always been the story about this racetrack, Rachel. It was once reportedly having 36 degrees of banking. It's been repaved twice in the last 10 years. First, I think it was back in 2007. People complained about it, so they repaved it again. It's what it is now. And, well, technically progressive banking, but this racetrack, it does produce good racing. If there's ever a place, though, that you need to use that chrome horn, it's most likely to be here.
Yeah, and it's also one of the places where that chrome horn can cause the most damage, of course. This is a very narrow racetrack, and just like Dover, the Monster Mile, this is a self-cleaning racetrack. Everything that goes up will come down. That banking will send anything to the bottom of it, and probably the safest place to pass cars that are spinning is right against that wall. Of course, the track is looking pretty good tonight, and with the weather we have right now, 79 degrees Fahrenheit, with a wind that's moving between 4 and 5 miles an hour from the east, it's pretty humid, so going to be quite a quick track tonight.
Indeed, son, of course, like we are tonight recognizing the life and career of Steve Byrnes, who was for many years, of course, a host and most famously on Fox NASCAR from 2001 all the way through to 2014, right there on the very first broadcast. And well, Rachel, Steve Byrnes, of course, he became a familiar household name for Fox NASCAR ever since they took over NASCAR coverage in 2001. He was recognized as one of the voices of NASCAR for many, many years. And it's in some ways a shame that we lost him just a couple of days after the Bristol Motor Speedway race named in his honor just a month or so ago. Well, just a couple of weeks ago, actually. But simultaneously, what a great guy and what a voice for the NASCAR community.
Yeah, he was indeed, and well, Steve Byrnes is a voice and a name that I recognize so much from watching NASCAR on Fox, and he's just one of those personalities that made the sport so exciting and so interesting. Great rapport with the drivers, and they always had good words whenever he was talking to them, so it was it's tragic that he's gone, and definitely thoughts and prayers with his family.
Indeed, so as you can see there, we're just heading ourselves now, just a couple of seconds remaining in qualifications. That checkered flag has just got itself out on top of the Eisen.com flag stand. So we'll be heading ourselves to the starting grid in just one moment's time. That gives us the opportunity then to run through your starting grid for tonight's event. Well, there you can see it will be the 01 car of Nate Lacome in the 01 Club Florida machine. Qualifying time of 15.920, claiming pole position here today with Clint Carr in the Club Plains number 5 car, just 0.04 of a second back. Bronson Stafford in P number 3 in the number 20 Club Canada car, with Mike Teller making it an all-Canadian row number 2. We head on back, and you can see that you got yourself Ryan Borges there in P number 5, with William Kruczka in P6, Lev Zielinski in P number 7, James Silvers on the outside of row number 4, and then further back, Steve Bonesteel in P9 and Evan Pozosko in P number 10. Justin Krinsky in 11th, Dalton Alexander in the 12th position. And then heading on back a little bit further on the inside of row number 7, it'll be Michael Thompson, outside Michael Flensen. And then on the inside of row number 8, Shane Trim and Jason Thompson on the outside of row number 8. And they can see the last of your drivers then. John Diekman, Corey Belvind, and Cody Table. We'll step aside for just one moment. We'll be back for the start after this message. You're watching RaceSpot TV. I'll take you side by side.
The NASCAR Peak Antifreeze Series powered by iRacing.com has officially begun.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. You can see there one of two pace laps has been scored complete. We'll get a look then at our aerial coverage from Bristol Motor Speedway. We are almost set to go racing here today in the 24designs.com night race at Bristol in memory of Steve Byrnes. And here you can see your field then working itself around the banking here at Bristol Motor Speedway. And well, in just one moment's time, we're going to get ourselves ready to go green at this magnificent, beautiful racetrack. One of the most famous in the entirety of the NASCAR Sprint Cup Series circuits, and well, arguably one of the most famous ovals in the world. And in fact, next year it'll be hosting itself for the triple race. We'll talk about that one over the course of this event. Pace car is on towards pit road, and we start this race now. And towards turn number one, then the drivers come for the first time. Nice two wide action, a little bit of a wiggle there as he tries trying to get themselves single file for the first time. Everyone making it through lap number one. Cars all the way high up the racetrack, Rachel, but we get everyone through lap number one by the looks of it. A couple of drivers very loose of four. We've got a car warring around the wall. That's a number 88 Red Bull machine. We've got ourselves another car. All forms of bumping going on in this first stage of this race.
Yep, three wide several times there, and some definite bumper action going on as cars narrowly avoid some major potential incidents there. And we do have a car spinning onto the inside wall there.
Yeah, that is Evan Pasako there, and that will bring the caution out in that Club West car. They can see the pace car is out onto the racetrack with just three laps going to be scored complete this time by that Club West number 13 car. The early victim here today. Let's get ourselves another look at that one as we're riding on board of him. And well, Rachel, that's the thing, early laps at Bristol, well, you never really get the chance to stop here. But Evan, just having looked there at the number 18 car, it just looks as though that car is going to get loose. It's actually trying to avoid the NVIDIA car ahead of him who smacked the wall. And well, that number 13 car is now going to have himself some rather substantial front end damage. Also going to have to probably get them quite a bit of repairs done to that car.
He is indeed, and the number 10 there, James Silver, is showing his displeasure to the 18 well, we're not entirely sure, but the initial start of this race was what I'd expect in the last five laps at Bristol, Will. It was incredibly aggressive, and everyone looking to make up places early, which, on a track where you are pretty much running the top line, it's vital to make places when you can, but perhaps a little too energetic for the start of this one, and, well, it's paid off in a caution on lap five.
Yeah, we've got ourselves William Kritzker on pit road. We saw him riding the outside wall down on lap number one. He's going to get himself four fresh tyres, going to get himself a couple of repairs done to his race car as well. You've got Justin Grinsky then coming out of pit road. It's a 31.5 second stop for him. It's a 29.9 second stop there for William Kritzker. And Jason Krisny there, 31.5 second stop. So he comes back on the straight track. Nate Lacome from the race lead, let's not forget, in that car is, well, 39.1 seconds, and that NVIDIA car actually is the one that we saw just ahead of Evan, Rachel, who pretty much caused that caution as Evan had to check off.
Yeah, it was, and as I mentioned earlier, saw that car showing its displeasure to the 18 on the racetrack. He really wasn't happy about something that had gone on under green flag, but this is Bristol, and you can show your emotions quite physically on this racetrack, but of course, drivers coming in getting a little bit of repairs that they might need. Definitely more than three or four cars having a bit of a bump and a bang in those first laps. So hopefully early frustrations out the window right now, we can get a good clean restart.
Well, here we are then. You can see those lights are going off on top of the RaceSpot pace car as we get our first caution of the day in the books. And there you can see that ticker running along the top of your screen. There'll be seven laps scored complete out of 200 here. The laps tick off incredibly quickly. Now, if this race goes green to the end, we'll probably get the entire race distance done in about lasts only 1 hour. Of course, these drivers will have to come onto pit road to get themselves topped up onto no coat race fuel, get themselves some fresh tyres. Tyre wear can always be a big thing here at Bristol Motor Speedway, as we can have a look there on board. A clean car in that number five car, that pace car, any moment now. We'll make that journey back down towards pit road. We are getting ourselves ready for the restart here. And green flag, once again, back in the air. Nice 2x2 action as the cars work themselves back down in towards turn number one, Rachel.
Yeah, they do indeed. 20 getting a great start there. That's Haas automation machine of Bronson Stafford getting a great run through the corner. He takes that line, of course, and front of this field settling out one lane wide, but we do have some two wide action towards the rear. And early moves being made by the 26 there. That is the car of the 28, I apologise, Michael Fenlison.
As we ride along board of him then, as they work themselves down towards the start finish line once again, but another lap in the books now. Everyone did get through without any real incident that time by. It's interesting to note that we do technically have every single car on the racetrack at the very rear of the field. It's Cody Tabor then in the number three Club Virginia's car. Now, it's worth noting, Rachel, that even with a small field like this, just 19 drivers taking the green flag here today, as we're having a look at that battle for the race lead, Bronson Stafford actually going to the point, even at this very short short field here today, you will get lap traffic coming into play very early on, arguably in the next 10 laps or so, as clean car giving that chrome horn then to Bronson Stafford as they come back down into one.
Yeah, indeed, and you'll typically see lap traffic here between 10 to 15 laps, and depending how big the field is, of course, because when the leaders actually take the flag, you are practically half a lap down, even with 20 cars. So, big wobble there from that 28 car of Michael Fenlison. He saves that nicely, but yeah, lap traffic, major issue. It's one of the few tracks where you'll see the lap traffic staying low in the corners. Let the leaders have that top line.
Yeah, got ourselves a little bit of two wide racing right now. This is Kobe Belmont working himself down to the inside and past that number 17 car. That number 17 is going to be high on the outside line as they come back down through turn number one. As here you can see, Nathan Moke trying to merc himself back through the field, although Rachel, that 0-1 car is damaged. He did get himself some repairs during that first caution of the day, but he is well off pace compared to where he qualified, because he's running himself down in P number 14 right now, down 13 spots from where he qualified. His last lap about 3/10 of a second slower than what he's able to do at the start of this event.
Well, indeed, but of course he had clean air then, Will, let's not forget, and right now he's back in traffic. You have to have a lot of patience as well as aggression here at Bristol, so you've got to pick those moments, and you know, you do have to ride big hit there from that number 88 car there of the Red Bull machine of William Krasaka. He got went straight into the back of that 60, but everyone got away with that pretty cleanly. As I was saying, yeah, you've got to be patient back here in traffic. It's busy. You can't take the line you want, you can't take the speed you want, so you've got to be very careful when you make those moves. So I don't think his car's as damaged as we might think. I think Lacombe definitely has some power under that hood, but he's got to be careful coming back through the field.
Yeah, as we ride along board then, once again, with that number 01 car, as he heads himself back down to the inside, he will go with that number 24 machine of Corey Belvings. Now, the outside line is today's preferred line around here. And you can see that, Rachel, this track has become, over the years, a little bit like Darlington, where the fastest times are found closest towards the 0-1 car running there, just tagging the wall and the run down in towards turn number one. And, well, this is not what we expected from this driver. There's a little bit too wide racing going on just ahead of him. You see the number 88 car, into the wall. But a bit too hard racing going on, and as I said, Rachel, you've got yourself the opportunity to find the fastest times up at the wall. 60 car, we're slamming it there, but that means if you're on the inside line, it's very, very difficult for you to make that pass, especially as those tyres fall away. You're going to have to be very careful, almost tiptoe down on that inside line, and that's where this field will get bunched up if you run 4 or 5 laps side by side, the inside line, outside line, kind of working together.
Yeah, absolutely. And what you really need, of course, is for the green flag to run a little bit. You'll get trucks backing up into one another. And once you have that line, when the first car goes into the corner on the high side, of course, that will check up the cars behind. That's the perfect chance to go to the low side because it will be slower than normal green flag running. So you kind of have to wait for the traffic to bunch before you can really make some good passes here at Bristol. That 88 car, though, he has been in the wall again. But let's be honest, this is Bristol. Everybody will finish this race with some sort of paint rubbed off their car and onto that safer barrier, because, well, it's Bristol. And the 88 car, I think he's trying a new strategy of making his car as narrow as possible by hitting that wall repeatedly, trying to sneak down the middle.
Well, let's have a look then on board with Ryan Borges. He runs himself in third place. He's been closing up to the rear of Clint Carr. And now Carr's going to have to go from being offensive, and he was right on the rear of Brunson Stafford just a couple of laps ago. He's now playing defense, and whilst this is going on, it's allowing Stafford to just start pulling away at number 20 with Kashin.
Big loose moment there from Steve Bonesteel. He had that car sideways, that 25 CFI machine, coming out of turn four. There is a bit of a transitional there in four-wheel. Oh, we have a caution out.
So we are back to caution. This is because of Corey Belvin's in that number 24 machine. So he's got that car turned around. The iris.com first safety car is going to come back out. Let's get yourself a couple of very quick replays then. We'll start by having a look at the driver, number 25 machine of Steve Bonesteel. Let's have a look then to see him getting mighty wicked loose. And this will be just one corner's time from here. He did actually just tag the wall back end of turn two. That caused him to lose momentum. Actually, the number 28 car almost running into the rear of him through turn number three and four. And then simultaneously, we then had ourselves the number 24 machine of Corey Belvin getting tagged around there by the 01 machine down in towards turn number three and four, causing himself, actually, it was a free car incident when all was said and done, Rachel. But pit road is open. It's a very, very busy place right now.
It is indeed. We have 28 laps scored right now. Fuel tank should be looking in the region of maybe 120 laps, I believe. So there will be more than one stop to this one, definitely. Number 10 went through his pit box. They had to back up to get service. But, yeah, like I said, impatience of a fast car trying to get back to the front. And, well, Nate Lacomi just a little too impatient and got into the back of that 24 machine. This is what I said about going to the low side. The truck on the bottom side, the car on the bottom side, has a tendency to wash up. And that means you can get in the bottom of a car you're trying to, into the corner of a car you're trying to pass. But just to finish my point, though, regarding Mr. Bonesteel, of course, his car, there is a transition over turn four. It's a lot wider than to the exit of turn two, so you find that there is definitely a bit more speed perhaps you can get, but with the angle of the banking and the transition to that straightaway, it does mean that the vehicle can get pretty loose, and you've got to be prepared for that, and he don't think he quite was, and that truck just nearly getting away from him, and we nearly had a major incident there, only for it to constantly further up the track, as things tend to do at Bristol.
Well, we've had a couple of drivers who have stayed out, most notably that number 60 machine, who is now classified in the race lead. But also, a couple of drivers scored a lap down, of course, right now. We've got Tony Table back out onto the racetrack. It's called multiple laps down. You can see 12 laps down. And Corey Belvin's actually brought that car onto pit road, as a couple of people are coming back onto pit road to get a little bit of topping up by the looks of it. So here is your race leader. Looking as though he will stay out on the racetrack for the time being. They will go back to green flag racing in about a lap and a half here. 30 laps out of 200 will be scored complete as they work themselves past start-finish line, which they will do any moment. Now, in fact, we're on the wrong end of the racetrack. So they'll do it in a moment's time, shall we say. But here are your top eight as they stand. It is the driver of Justin Quincy, who currently leads away. Then we've got ourselves number 38 machine in second place. Borges in third, then Stafford, Carr, Bonesteel, Clayston, and Alexander rounding out your top eight here on RaceSpot TV. Get that ticker running along the top of your screen once again. Lights are now off on top of the iris.com first safety car, 01 car, heading himself back onto the racetrack. He's been involved in the wards a little bit here today, trying to get himself back up through the field, but he has now scored all the way down in P number 17 on the racetrack. The last driver on the lead lap, Corey Belvin, will be classified as one lap down. He'll be actually hoping for caution to get himself the wave around, get himself back onto the lead lap. Pace car then gonna head itself back on towards pit road, and we will head ourselves back to green flag racing here in the 24designs.com night race at Bristol in memory of Steve Byrnes. Pace car in, we go back to green, we will show you the sights and sounds of Bristol Motor Speedway.
This could be a really poor decision, Will, for that number 60 truck, of course. Caution came out behind them, but as I was going to say, old tyres, and this could be critical for him now. He can come into the pit road and get service, because those old tyres, you saw that Constantino on the start line, really can't get away as fast.
Yeah, there we can see the reason for the caution. Number 21 car, John Diekman, Well, looks like that engine's pretty much blown up, and we'll get ourselves another look at that one. Right on board with him then, in that number 21 car, under our third caution of the day. We'll show you this one from the restart, and as it so often happens when you've got a mixture of two tyres, four tyres, well, Diekmann really just lost that one all by himself, Rachel, trying to get that power down. There was nothing anyone really else around him can do other than come to a complete sliding halt. And that means now that we have got ourselves our third caution of the day.
We do indeed. That 97 truck there of Mike Talia, probably a bit damaged, but not quite as bad as that 3. 12 laps down, of course, Cody Tabor, he's out now. That engine is blown. Same goes for Diekmann, but yeah, that's a classic case of no tyres, Will. He put his foot down and, well, it decided to go the way it wanted to, which was right. Not much you can do to stop it other than get off the gas, but here at Bristol there's no room to go, so unfortunate for them, and this is some sign of why you need to be careful, and definitely a moment of relief, I think, for the 38 of Therrien and Pazeski at the front in that 60 truck, because they now can come and get tyres. But do they want to sacrifice track position?
Well, you've had yourself Corey Belvin getting himself the free pass, as we alluded to a moment ago, and he will immediately come on towards pit road, get himself some fresh boot. And out front, it is going to be Shane Thurin who takes over the lead of this race for the time being. Justin Kurinski still scored on the racetrack. Neither of them have come onto pit road just yet. We'll step aside for just one moment. We'll be back for the restart after this.
What is it about speed? Do these rivals chase speed because they can? Or because they can't help it? IndyCar, the heart of racing. Go to IndyCar.com for live timing and scoring, upcoming race details, and to join the conversation.
Here's a look then at your race leader. It is Shane Thurin in the number 38 car, who so far today led himself a total of four laps. Your lap leaders so far today, you have yourself number 38 car leading himself four laps. Justin Kurinski leading four laps himself. Bronson Stafford led 20 laps. Clint Carr has led seven. Got a couple of drivers scored as out of the race or on pit road. There you can see the number three car of Cody Tabor. He is classified as out of the race for the time being. You've got Levi Zielinski coming out of pit road in the Club Michigan car. The 0-1 car been in the wars here today. Lena Mokey's led himself six pit stops already today. And, well, you've also got John Diekmann. He has scored well down the field in that number 21 car. You can see those lights are out on top of the eyes are not calm. First safety car. Any moment now, it will head itself back down on towards pit road. Working himself on the exit of corner number two down this very straight back straight away. You'll notice actually here that the top speed of these cars is very minimal. You literally are only on the gas for a handful of seconds when you have to get out, crank that wheel, and get on the brakes. You make yourself another turn at the last great Coliseum here. As the eyes are not calm, first safety car will put itself back onto pit road. A little bit of banging side drafting there. Front end of your pack. We do go back to green flag racing. 38 and the 60 car on the front row, they're all packed up again. Number 25 car always running into the rear with that Haas automation. Number 20 car, trouble! 60 car turned around, that's the big one!
Yep, that is certainly the big one, Will, and that was spectacularly unlucky. 20 car with a big run, but he was just not patient enough. The 60 car, of course, old tyres. You don't go that hard on a restart.
Well, there is the number 60 car of Justin Kurinski, as the Eisen.com first safety car is back out on the race. Right, let's get ourselves another look at this one then from his perspective. Let's ride it along board with him first, and we can show you what happened. And this is that run then towards start finish line. You can just hear now the engines coming to life as we head ourselves back to green flag racing. Keep an eye on that number 20 Haas automation car, just tagging him there down in towards turn and one. Justin Kurinski getting himself turned around, slammed into wall. I am so surprised, Rachel, that that one wasn't any bigger than it was. It looked as though there's some great heads-up driving of people actually getting themselves out of the way as quick as they can. We'll have ourselves another look from our And One Design Super Slow Mo replay.
Yeah, absolutely, and one of the advantages of Bristol is the corners are so damn small, you can see what's going on right ahead of you, and, well, I think that hit for the 60 got him straightened out in the end. He got slammed up into the wall, but it straightened him out, and there were no cars actually sideways across the track to get hit, so everyone managed to scrape and bump and bang, but genuinely fit through that one. It could have been a lot worse.
Oh, it so easily could have been. Let's get ourselves in. There is our look at our and one design. Super slow my replay. As our number 60 car gets tagged and turned around right across the front of that number 20 Haas Automation car. Number 25 of Steve Bonesteel right behind him. That's the second time he's had a near miss here today. Number 98 car. The other CFI car involved in there as well. Bonesteel actually then comes together with his teammate. Number 16 car there as well. So Bonesteel, that's looking as though he's got himself a little bit of damage, as should his teammate. So gonna have to figure out this one as it plays out over the course of this caution. Got a couple of drivers then scored on pit road. You've got James Steele, Silver's coming out of pit road right now. Bronson Stafford though did lead the group of drivers who came onto pit road that time by Rachel, and well, it was a 15.9 second stop for him as he leads a group of drivers involving Michael Thompson, Evan Prosecco, Mike Tiller, and Levi Zielinski on to and off of the pits.
Yeah, they will indeed, and well, I'm surprised that a few of those cars haven't actually gone back into the pits for some tyres. Of course, the 38 hasn't pitted, the 60's still out there after that whopper. Yeah, this is what happens when you get tyres even 15 laps old here. You slide them on the restart, you slow her in the corners on the first run through, and it just gets so messy with cars behind perhaps not checking up as much as they should and being as patient as they might be off the restart. It's going to cause problems, and well, this is 200 laps. Patience is required here at Bristol, and hopefully we'll start to see some of that as the field starts to thin itself down, because either we're going to run out of cars to hit each other or they'll learn.
Well, there you can see Clint Carr in the number 5 car right along board with him as those lights are back off on top of the ice. Not calm, first safety car. We'll get ourselves ready. Go green flag racing. 43 laps, all complete. 4 cautions so far here today in the Checkered Flag Racing League 24 Designs.com night race at Bristol Motor Speedway in memory of Steve Byrnes. There's a look then at your track temperature here today. It's very humid here today. The wind, well, that was not showing up on our screen, but it's anywhere between about 4 or 5 miles an hour throughout the course of this event. And it's just crashed our roof lane, which is going to make our lives interesting. We are going to head ourselves though back to green flag racing here at Bristol. There is a look as the drivers getting themselves back down towards turn one. A little bit of beating going on again. That was Steve Bonesteel still there, just tagging the rear of that number 5 car. Very slow car, turned around once again. 28 car, down in towards turn number 1. We'll get ourselves a look at it, and we do stay green this time somehow, Rachel.
We do indeed there. That's Fenn Larsson getting turned around. Well, he does seem to get a really slow restart there. He got tagged, actually, by that 25 car, I believe. He got into the rear quarter panel of that truck, turned him round, clipped him, turned him straight again, like that last caution. It straightened him up and got him going. A bit of patience from the pack behind, and everyone's going once again, so could have been hairy, but, wow, we need patience here. This is getting a bit exciting.
Yeah, there you can see then that number 28 car of Fenn Larsson, and he just comes down the racetrack, almost causes calamity there, the number 88 Red Bull car, but they do stick it together. Good heads up driving by the rear part of your field. We are still undergraining, battle for P3 going on as Shane Thuren, then he's going to make himself up one position as Justin Krinsky down now into third place. Mike Carr down into P4. As you see, still a little bit of two-wide racing going on, actually. And this is that battle for P2. We have got ourselves a couple of technical issues down in that section of the field. But Steve Bonesteel still going side-by-side right now with late Lacome. These two drivers have been at it all race long, side-by-side, as they head themselves along this high progressive banking. Number 13, LSR TV car of Evan Prosecco alongside as they went themselves still two-wide there. Haas Automation car down on the inside, Rachel.
He was, and Prosecco got into the wall back then, just clipped the exit, safer barrier there in that truck, but carried on just fine. Could have been bad if he came off the wall there and came down on that 20 car, but getting away with it pretty well right now, and good run there by Prosecco. Oh, that was a great run through now. 60 car really slow though off turn 2, and the 88 is making traction right now.
William Krutzke going side by side with Justin Krinsky as that number 60 car is falling through the field. And part of the reason for that one, Rachel, is the fact that it's been a while since he actually last come down onto pit road. Those tyres are wearing out for him now, and he's kind of made a bad strategic call, in my opinion, as they are too wide, too deep behind him.
They are indeed, and well, that could end in tears, but yeah, tyres so valuable here, and you need, yeah, whilst track position is important, we've seen. But the number of cautions, maybe not as important as you might think. I'd come down for fresh rubber every start. just because it gives you a better opportunity to get away from the danger. The 25 car gets very wiggly there as the 20 of Stafford. That Haas Automation Chevy gets just into the side of him a little bit, and that 25 CFI car truck even is not looking too happy right now. He's super loose.
Yeah, running on board then with William Krushko trying to look down to the inside of that number 60 car as they head themselves. And this is down towards, well, very close there past the start finish line, down into one once again. Well, Krushko actually just catching the transition of that banking. We've got a car rule riding there just ahead of them. That is car actually scored a lap down by the looks of it. It's that CFI car. Let's have a look a little bit further ahead. There's Dayton Alexander even in that number 98 car. He's the one who actually bridge the roll a moment ago. There's a side by side once again behind him. William Krushko heading himself down to the inside of that 60 car. He kind of needs to get himself alongside before he gets into the corner, which is what he's doing now. That might give him the opportunity to just get the momentum and exit. Not able to do it that time by, but they remain side by side. So they come down in towards turn at number one. Out of one and two they come, Rachel. And that 88 car just cannot make that move down on the inside. This time he should get himself another good run. We're having a look from the rear of him. And nope, they remain side by side once again.
Yep, they do indeed. And that's battle that's going to be carrying on for quite a while as things stand. And well, hopefully those two cars can get around each other. As the 25 and the 10 make contact. 25 going into the wall there. As, well, the 10 he wants passed. And, well, Lacombe does want to try and recover from what he's lost so far. Yeah. No, that's the 0-1 even. I apologise. I'm looking at it upside down.
There is the number 25 car. As you see, he's got himself a little bit of front-end damage, actually. We talked about that one a little bit earlier on in this event. Lacombe, well, he's looking down to the inside once again. They head themselves back down off the banking then in that number 25 car, past start finish line, but another lap in the books. Now we're working ourselves on lap number 59 of 200. So there's a look then from the rear of Steve Bone still. There's a number 18 car behind him, but it's the 01 car, he's down on his inside, that's causing him the issue. As Lacombe back down to the inside, he's actually going to lose out. Lacombe getting loose there on the exit of turn number four, comes back up the racetrack into the path of number 24. That was another very close call, Rachel. Good heads-up driving by that number 24 machine.
Yeah, very good heads-up driving there and avoiding a really dangerous situation. So, big, big props for that one.
As there is a look at Corey Belvin's number 24 car. We'll actually go back and have a look at Lake Lacombe then. This is down through turn number 3 and 4. Just catching that transition. Skyler's going to get loose on the exit of the corner right about there. And so many times I've seen drivers slam into that inside safer by. He then comes back up the racetrack in a very good heads-up drive there by the number 24 machine to avoid making that a calamity. But again, Nate Lacombe, so he's off this time by. He's off. He's spinning it around. And that 0-1 car will bring out our fifth caution of the day. Sixth caution of the day, I do believe, on lap number 63. Well, I have to say, Rachel, that 0-1 car has, in fact, now officially hit everything except for the Arsenal.com first safety car.
Well, I believe he has, and give him a chance, he might get around to hitting that pace car. Just hits that wall, comes down off the wall into 18 track, and, well, he gets what was going to happen to him, and he ends up in the wall, but doesn't look too heavy. He should be able to continue here.
Well, there we are. There's a look at the incident for him once again. As he's coming back onto the racetrack, pit road is open this time by. We should expect to see a lot of drivers down on pit road this time by. In fact, we are going to see a lot of drivers on pit road this time by. But you can see Ryan Borges on pit road. You've got Shane Ferguson on pit road. Pretty much everyone worth their salt who hasn't yet pitted in a while, they are all on pit road as we speak. Ryan Borges then going to get himself four fresh tyres. He'll top himself up with Sunoco Racefield. We've got Brunson Stafford, Clint Carr. They are all on pit road. The exception to the rule is this driver. It is Jason Thompson, as he's working himself down the back straightaway. Everyone else is on pit road right now. The winner out of pit road, well, that'll be Ryan Borges then. 14.6 seconds, exactly the same as Clint Carr, as they work themselves back out onto the racetrack. Shane Thurian there doing himself a 15 second stop. 14.8 second stop for Dalton Alexander. William Krushko, 14.6 second stop as well. So that is pretty much norm. Looks so most drivers came in and came off in exactly the same place, although Brunson Stafford, very slow start for him, as he's going to get himself a couple of repairs. So we have a look then, back out and away in a slightly elongated time of 36.4 seconds. Whilst we have the opportunity, Rachel is going to have a quick chat with Cody Tabor.
Yes, indeed. I'm down here in pit road with Cody Tabor. Cody, number three truck, not so healthy today. Tell us how the race has been for you so far.
Well, most of the race we've set on pit road. We got a few laps in before the incident with the tire spin. Everybody checked up and ran into the 21 of John Diekman. I've been sitting on pit road right now, still got about 17 minutes left in repairs.
Well, the way things are going, of course, it does look like you will be able to get those repairs completed. Do you think you can make up any positions in your real true Chevy today?
What is it again? I didn't hear you all the way.
I was saying, chances are you'll be able to get those repairs completed. Do you think you can recover any positions in that real true Chevy?
With us being almost 40 laps down, I'd say not. I'd say more than likely we'll probably be done for the rest of the race.
Well, that's unfortunate for you guys, and hopefully better luck in the rest of the season, Cody.
Yeah, our CT3 Motorsports team have came through really strong this season. I mean, we picked up games right at the end of the season, and a lot of them are battling for a championship, like Clint Carr and Corey Blevins. So good luck to them for the rest of the season.
Indeed, well, thanks for coming and joining us here, and good luck with the rest of the season for you and the team.
All right, guys, thanks.
Your top eight so far, it is Ryan Borges, who, of course, led the field on and off of pit road. Clint Carr second, came through in third. Dalton Alexander, William Krushka, Evrena Prosecco, James Silvers, Jason Thompson, and Corey Belvins as it stands. This field then getting itself side by side, ready for the restart here on RaceSpot TV. Don't forget, there is plenty of action to come as we are into the month of May, including the Irish.com World Championship Grand Prix Series. Two rounds, one at Walkinshaw International, one at Virginia International Raceway. Also, RaceSpot TV's coverage of the Irish.com Indy 500 coming soon. Pace car is in. We are heading ourselves back to the restart here at Bristol Motor Speedway. 68 laps out of 200 scored complete.
Oh, the car in the wall. That's the 28 car, I believe. Well,
28 car.
It is, Finn Larsen.
So we do stay green for the time being. As Finn Larsen there, you can see in that Fastenal car down in the 15th position, but out front, Ryan Borges is leading. And the driver of Mike Carr, he's been struggling on restarts here today, Rachel. He's fallen down into P number three right now. And you can just see him ahead there in that Valvoline car. As in fact, he's going to go down to the inside of Dalton Alexander. Just clipped the wall there down the inside of turn number one. That'll be side by side. But Clint Carr has been a little bit slow on restarts here today.
It is indeed. That Valvoline Chevy looking a little bit worse for wear right now, though, as CFI number 98 Chevrolet on the outside of him getting a good run. He definitely has the line right now, especially with the navy Chevrolet there behind him of that 38 machine of Shane Terrien. So that will help him get past. No hole really for the 5 to get back up into. He will need that desperately. Probably going to be up behind the 38 there if he can get up before the 18 turns around, but that lane is closing fast and he is trapped in the slow lane.
Yeah, and there you can see Shane Thurin in the number 38 machine. He is right there behind his, behind the number 98 car. That Navy machine has two cars ahead of him, still going side by side. 73 laps will be scored complete this time by William Krushka having a battle as we speak with Evrena Prosecco. This is for P number 6, P number 7. You can see the gap just ahead of him. This side-by-side racing for the last five or so laps, Rachel, ever since this restart, has really allowed that pack behind him to catch up. Although Clint Carr has now moved himself back into P number 2.
He has indeed. Great run there by him, and it was the fighting behind him that really helped him get that completed. So a real advantage to him. I thought he was going to get freight train backwards, but wow, the leader's checked out right now. Ryan Borges is just disappearing. That truck right... Well, I believe that is actually the... I can't tell. 24 Downs Designs truck, actually. Getting away ahead. He's got about second and a half right now on the field. And Bristol, that's a hell of a lot, Will.
Yeah, there you can see Ryan Borges gap between himself and Clint Carr. The number 32 to number 5 car is 1.4 seconds. Head on back, though. You can see we've actually just had a chain for position. Clint Carr in second. Shane Thurston down to the inside, making that pass complete then. Over the number 98 car of Dalton Alexander for the time being. Although that number 98 car is going to be able to push up high. This is also number 18 machine of James Silvers into the mix. He gets loose on the exit of the corner to allow Evan Prosecco up into a position. And the number 88 car, William Krushka, just pushing a little bit too high. Got ourselves great racing though in this mid pack. As car into the wall there. That's the number 98 machine, Dalton Alexander. That is off of corner number 4. Down towards one they come once again, Rachel. We do stay clean for the time being. 24 machine is off as well. Replay coming up on your screen.
It is indeed, and we had a bit of a getting together with a bunch of those cars there. 24 getting sideways because, well, one of the other cars seems to have hit most things on the track. That 20 truck of, that is Branson Stafford. He just gets into the quarter panel of 24 and he puts him around. 24 saves it and holds on. Big Constantino above him, the 25 and that 61. But most cars get away with it. 24 does not. He's hard into the inside wall.
Yeah, there we can have a look. There you can see. Corey Belvin's then. Well, he's struggling now. He is actually still going. But some severe damage to that number 24 car out front. Gavin Borges and Clint Carr down to 1.3 seconds. Last time by, it was a 16.4 there for Ryan Borges. It was a 16.3 for Clint Carr. That gap has come down by about a tenth of a second the last lap or so. James Lewison is actually now 1.1 seconds behind Clint Carr with James Silvers. This field is right now getting very, very spread out. This is what these drivers want, to be able to get themselves a little bit of green flag running in here. It's a case now of trying to get this field settled down, get himself past halfway, and see what can happen after that.
It is indeed, and of course, with the cautions we've had, pit cycle will be offset somewhat, so we're looking at maybe like 150 before green flag stops are really necessary at this stage. So, with the field spreading out now, I do think we should get a reasonable green flag run as things stand. But of course, back in the pack, we still have some two-wide racing. I believe Jason Thompson, Steve Bonesteel rounded the corner. We have caution out.
Yeah, that'll be the number 25 car. Hard into the wall there. Driver squeezing, threading the needle. As Bonesteel just sliding down the racetrack. 0-1 car is involved in that one. Let's get ourselves another look at that one for you. As we'll have a look there. There is that number 25 car of Steve Bonesteel. As the driver's worked himself down in towards turn number one. And well, that 0-1 car you can see coming up behind them. Through the corner and then just tagging the rear there. Bonesteel has worked himself down the back straightaway, tagging him again for good measure, pushing him up into the number 61 car there. Actually, that is Jason Thompson. But well, it looks like Bonesteel has now got himself a lot more damage. And well, that 0-1 car, Rachel, continuing his game of bingo, as I'm going to call it.
Bingo, Dodgems, British Bulldog. There are many names we can use for the 0-1's race so far. Chaotic is certainly amongst them. That car seems to have been involved in most of the incidents so far, either on the receiving end or the protagonist's side. But as things stand, I can't quite entirely blame him for that incident. 25 truck did come down off the corner now. Whilst that's kind of the line, it was a 50-50 deal, I really think, in that instance, where the two just seem to come together on track. And it's a tough one. Yeah, the initial hit, probably blame the 25, but 0-1 kept his foot in and tagged the 25 a second time, and well, that went wrong.
We are looking at a couple of drivers then as they make a journey onto pit road to get themselves another pit stop. We're going to step aside for just a moment, ladies and gentlemen. We'll be back after this message. We'll take you RaceSpot TV side by side.
Details and to join the conversation.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to RaceSpot TV. And don't forget, coming your way at the end of the month, we have ourselves coverage of the iRacing.com Indianapolis 500 for the sixth year. Sim Racing's biggest event rolls into action. That will be Saturday, May 30th. Start time yet to be confirmed. Welcome back then. As you can see, the eyes are not calm. First safety car has its lights out, and that means one thing. We're almost ready to go back to green flag racing, as that pace car will any moment now dart itself down on towards pit road, and that will put the field in the command of the number 88 car of William Kuchka, who cycled through to the race lead. That navy car going to be alongside him as the green flag is back out here at Bristol. 90 laps score complete. Oh, but the number 88 car very slow on that restart. That allows Shane through him to really get himself a good jump, although 88 car is bonding. He's looking back down to the inside. Through turn number 3 and 4 they come then, as they are too wide once again, Rachel, through about P3 all the way through to about P6.
Yeah, they are indeed, and of course this field singling out pretty quickly. These guys have worked out how to do restarts here at Bristol, but weather's certainly not helping things. It's a little on the slick side, so definitely making it a challenge. And you see these trucks coming out of turn 4, they're getting very sideways as a bunch of cars have to try and get past that 24 back in the pack there, as he has a slow run. But looking like positions are being fought over right now, and well, the 88 hasn't got much to gain on the Navy 38 truck ahead of him, but looks like that 28 truck there of Finn Larson will might have a good round. The 88 is getting very, very sideways there. Nearly had him.
Trouble on the racetrack. We got ourselves two cars turned around. Number 13 car turned around there. Number 88 car as well. Big incident back end of the racetrack. And there you can see the number 16 car, Michael Thompson, involved in that one. Back under caution here, getting ourselves then a look at this one on the RaceSpot TV Super Slow Mo replay, trying to figure out exactly what happened.
It started, Will, back in turn one. It was actually the 88 truck ahead of the 28 there. He tags the wall on the entrance to turn one. That puts him sideways, and that puts him onto the bumper of the 28, who just touches him lightly after that big checkup he made. And he's loose on the exit, catches the 13 and puts him in the outside wall.
Yeah, there's a look then at William Kuchka in that Red Bull Sirius XM Toyota as he works himself through turn one. You see pretty much sideways, four-wheel drifting. Drivers then trying to all scatter around him. Number 18 car gets doesn't get collected. He does eventually there. And it's the number 13 car who took the biggest brunt of that damage. That was, of course, the LSR TV machine of Evan Pazeko as well. A couple of drivers now really damaged. Number 24 car engine has expired on him, so that is him done for the time being. Whilst we're under caution, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to step aside for just one more minute. We'll be back after this. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, as we have a look on board with your race leader, number 38, Club New England car, who has now led 18 laps so far in today's event. Your race lap leader as we approach halfway is being the number 32 car. There we are, of Ryan Borges, coming up on your screen right now. He's led himself a total of 43 laps here today. And Bronson Stafford, he led some laps early. He's currently scored down in the Haas situation car in 8th place after leading 20 laps in this race overall, as the field gets itself back then to two wide, ready for the restart. It's actually the 25 car trying to find a way to feed back into things. That number 25 car is Steve Bunstead. Of course, he was involved in the wars a little bit earlier on, but there you are, a look at your race leader working themselves down the back straightaway, getting themselves ready for the restart. And one lap after this, we'll be at the halfway point the24designs.com night race at Bristol Motor Speedway in memory of Steve Byrnes. Pace car is in. We go back to green then. 99 laps to 200 scored complete. Very slow restart there by the number 38 car. That allows the number 28 on the outside line to get a huge jump there side by side behind them there, Rachel, as they race towards halfway.
They are indeed, and we're going to be halfway this time by the line. Big jump by Finn Larsen there in the 28 Fastenal Chevrolet, getting a good run out that corner. He will hold the lead for now, two wide behind him. Looking at three wides, that 20 decides better than putting his car into a very dodgy position. But the field's settling out now, two by two by two behind third place.
Yeah, there you can see Ryan Borges, he's trying to move himself back for the field to say he led the most laps in the first half of this race with 43. Michael Fenlinson, though, has led himself his third lap of the day in that fast and old car. Well, Rachel, he was in the wars a little bit earlier on, but now Michael Fenlinson is picking up the speed half a second between himself and Shane Thurisson.
It is indeed, and Thurisson's just been in the wall once, but I think the way things are going so far, this is a race of survival, Will, and whoever gets to the end will probably deserve it, because right now there's not a single undamaged panel on one of these tracks.
Yeah, it's interesting to note, luckily for that number 13 machine, he's been able to, even though he was involved in the last caution, still running in the fourth place. And here's the thing about this racetrack, Rachel, is that you can sustain damage and survive. It's not like a track like Atlanta Motor Speedway where, you know, you've got to have yourself really, really good aerodynamic grip throughout the race. This one, you can use driver skill. It's a little bit like the Monaco of NASCAR in some ways, that you can really just hurry a damaged car around the racetrack. We see it year after year after year in the NASCAR Sprint Cup Series, the Camping World Truck Series, the Xfinity Series. We're seeing that a little bit here today.
Yeah, this is one of those places where you'll see cars looking like modified as they rip bodywork off them they don't really need. Yeah, panels get beaten, extra bars and reinforcement gets fitted to these vehicles for the racing. And, well, they need it because it's a lot of chrome horn action, a lot of bumpers bruised. As I mentioned, it's not a single panel on one of these trucks that isn't bent right now. If you can, someone can show me a clean truck, I will be gobsmacked. But, yeah, it's all about mechanical grip here at Bristol. It's about getting that vehicle turning in the corner. And the aero package is not as big a factor. So, of course, yeah, with it being so tight and so banked, it does make up for that.
You know what, Rachel? I think I found one.
Really?
Almost. The number 18 car. Just a little bit of paintwork being scraped off. Apart from that, that car is pretty darn perfect.
Sorry to break it to you, Will, but his left front quarter panel is bent in.
Yeah.
And sorry, we wouldn't want you to be spoiled, to quote Days of Thunder.
As you see, a couple of other drivers having a look down the rear of the field there. They can see the number 16 car on Michael Thompson. Nice tribute to Steve Byrnes throughout that car, throughout sponsorship, and of course, nice image of Steve Byrnes on that deck lid as well. Down in the field, you've got yourselves. Well, let's see a one car, Rachel. How that is still running, I have no idea, but it is still running. He is down in P14, however, not really ever been able to recover ever since getting pole position for this race.
Falling down 25's pulled off the track. Bonesteel is off the track right now. He's parked, I believe, coming through turns 1 and 2. No problem. Oh no, 3 and 4, I apologise. He just pulls down to the apron, so probably some sort of mechanical failure with that truck. He's had to park it.
Well, yeah, we're having a look there for him. Just parks it, literally pulls off the racetrack. And well, that's not the way you go onto pit road if you see Byrnes still. So thing is though, that his day will anyway be done. His teammate though is running alongside, and you see 32 even the number 13 car side by side down in towards turn number 1 and 2. Are they at one end of the racetrack? You can see the number 18 machine of James Silvers, Evan Prosecco, getting side by side as they work themselves here in a nice little gaggle of cars, Rachel. They are single file for the most part, but there is still a little bit too wide racing. Evan has fallen down though ever since we last spoke about him. He's dropped down four positions in the last 10 laps or so.
Yeah, he has. It's not been great for him so far, but with the rate of attrition, that could factor back later on in the race as long as he can keep it clean. But as things are standing, we might be looking at a good run here, although we do have a couple of pods of cars getting very close together, which could end up being an issue. Of course, the leader now starting to lap traffic already, Michael Finn Larsen. Big, big lead now, 2.6 seconds to second place of Clint Carr and Valvoline Chevrolet. So he is checking out if things stay green.
Yeah, and actually this is the biggest lead we've seen all race long between Fenn Larsen and Clint Carr, as we have a look then at Fenn Larsen as he works himself back in of the racetrack in that club one, sorry, that club New England from 28 cars. Getting my series confused there just for a moment, Rachel.
You might be indeed. But yeah, lovely paint scheme on that Fastenal Chevrolet. Great looking truck, and well, representing New England Club. Yeah, things looking pretty good for him right now, of course. That lead is only widening from being in the wars and, well, being a bit of a punching bag early in this race. Did we think we'd see Michael Fenn Larsen here at the front of this race, Will?
Well, we don't know. He's had himself 20 laps, though, all of a sudden. So those laps are ticking off very quickly under green here. 120 laps out of 200 now scored complete. There's a look, then, at Clint Carr to Shane Vroon in P number two versus P number three, just 0.4 of a second. As that gap now up to 3 seconds on the racetrack. Ryan Borges, Borges and Stafford, they are scrapping it out. And these are two of the drivers who have led, in fact, P3, 4 and 5, Rachel, have led themselves a total of 75% of the race distance so far. But they are falling back dramatically. This one, I think, will come down to what these drivers are going to have to do when they make their next, and what will likely be, their final pit stop of the day.
Well, anyone that came down on lap 100, of course, will make it to the end of this race, theoretically, so. But you wouldn't want to do it with no tyres, of course. If you get a caution, you might not take fuel, but you will be coming down for fresh rubber on those on those tyres, because they don't last. And as we've seen from restarts, you can spin the tyres, you're slow in the corners. It's a major factor, but should things stay green, I gotta think I like the position Fenn Larsen's in right now. He's got a big lead, and it'll be hard on older tyres for drivers to make that sort of gap up here. The draft really isn't a big thing at Bristol. It doesn't really even show up. So he's not actually got a disadvantage, but the only problem I can foresee is he is catching a big gaggle of lap cars.
Yeah, there we can have a look then at Fenn Larsen, and there we can see his last lap time was a 16.381, up 13 positions since the start of today's event. There you can see at one point running all the way back in the 16th position, running the outside line well. There are a couple of drivers though who are going to be lapped very soon. We've currently got ourselves a total of 12 drivers in the lead lap. Mike Teller is the last one of those. There we can see he's down 8 positions from where he started today. He is third in line.
Oh, big wobble, Will. So I'm going to stop it there. Fenn Larsen, big wobble, and grazed the wall there in turn 3. Bit of a moment for that Fastenal Chevrolet.
Well, he does still go, and you can see just really pushing it. The gap is still 3.1 seconds, and ironically, he lost himself 0.3 of a second that last time by, but that gap is still 3 seconds overall. Those tyres starting to fall off, of course, and I think he just wanted to get himself as close to that traffic as he possibly can. You so often, Rachel, lose yourself time at that stage of the race when you get yourself into traffic here at Bristol. There you can see those 3 cars who are scored as laps down. And, well, the first one of those drivers is the number 61 machine of Jameson Thompson, who we can actually see there, is going to allow your race leader to go by on the high side. 61 car just holding himself in a nice steady line, and that will allow that race leader to go past. That will now put Jameson Thompson as 2 laps down in this event.
Well, next truck in line, of course, that 21 car of John Diekman in that big incident on the restart earlier, so so many laps down, he won't really fight this one very hard as your leader comes now to the out. Oh, leader's going to go to the inside, which is a different sort of move, but he makes it clean. Of course, next truck, that's a 97. This is where we start lapping lead lap cars, and we're only 12 on the lead lap so far. That number is going to shrink rapidly.
Well, yeah, there's actually 4 drivers in this gaggle of cars. You've got 01 machine, who's been in the wars a little bit here today. He's trying to work himself back through the field once again. That's Nate Lacome in the number 01 car. Ladies and gentlemen, it is 2:05 in the morning. I'm allowed to get tongue-tied once in a while. But Michael Fenn Larsen, there you can see him coming up towards a huge gaggle of cars right now.
And the big issue here, sorry, is that these guys are all going to try and fight to stay on the lead lap, and they don't want to get passed, so this could cause our own caution, which could hurt the leader.
And, of course, one of these drivers will get themselves a free pass if they are going to be side-by-side there. You can see the number 97 car is going to lose out there. Oh, Fenn Larsen getting himself a big wiggle through 4. This gap has come down, by the way, in half by half a second in the last mile or so of this event. 134 laps scored complete. If we were a Fox NASCAR, we'd go to commercial right now, but we're not. because the RaceSpot TV was slightly better than that. But Fenn Larsson, 2 seconds that gap is. They're side by side ahead of him. That's a number 16 car in the tier one machine. Leighton McCurry made there. Down to the inside of that number 16 car, Michael Thompson. These are lap down cars, battling a lead lap cars. You got yourself the race leader involved there as well. And, well, if you're the first driver in line, Rachel, to get lapped, it's okay. Oh, as Fenn Larsson almost making contact there with that number 97 machine on Mike Teller. That was very, very close.
It is. He's getting a bit impatient now. That time to the set car in second place of Clint Carr has dropped to 1.9 seconds, 1.8 now. He needs to get a shuffle on really quickly or he's going to be passed and caught in this traffic. I mean, you can go at Bristol, but once you get into traffic like this, this is where it stops. And look at this, too wide, too deep. And your leader's trying to get his way past. We've got a lap down car there as well. This is a little messier than I would like to see, of course. That 0-1 is already a lap down. This will be two for him. You know, he wants to stay on one to go, but he's fighting a little too hard with lead lap cars. And we have contact from the leader. That's a 16 turned around. He straightens up there.
Oh, yeah, and they all...
Round again.
Somehow made it through for the time being.
Nope. Caution.
And now we're under caution. Number five car in the wall then. So we are back under caution. And for some of these drivers, the fact they did get lapped, it was all, well, a little bit messy there. Get ourselves another replay of this one for you. And the person that you need to pay attention to is this one. Driver of Clint Carr, because he's the one who's going to get himself the most damage involved in this one. You see down in towards turn number one. Drivers are all going to sputter like Skittles, so to say. They were going three wide for the moment, then Clint Carr. The driver who gets the worst of it of the lead lap cars. Five car into the wall, taking out the number 38 machine for the time being as well. Oh, Shane Thurin, we are under caution. Well, some people aren't going to be too displeased with that one, Rachel, because now they can make their final pit stop of the day.
They can indeed, and of course, the biggest winner there is Fenn Larsson, because the two cars chasing him, the 38 and the 5, were in that wreck and heavily damaged, so he's got a free ticket if he could stay at the front of this race. I can't believe anybody in the lead lap will stay out here, because this is your final stop territory. This is fuel, and this is to the end on tyres. It's a reasonable run, so I can see this being everybody. Of course, Fenn Larsson gets the run out of pit road. He will be the first car back on the track.
Yeah, it is Fenn Larsson, 14.1 seconds. Who we've also got ourselves Borges there coming out of pit road, 15.8 seconds. Branson Stafford in third in line. Got a couple other drivers coming out of pit road as we speak. But it's Fenn Larsson who once again leads away here at Bristol Motor Speedway. We'll take your RaceSpot TV side by side for just one moment. We shall be right back. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. We won't show you the end of the advert because the pace car is going to head itself back on towards pit road, and that's more important. Van Larsen versus Borges then. So we go back to Green Flag Racing. 144 laps scored complete, this time by Green Flag. Back in the air, we are back to racing, and Van Larsen then putting that pressure free wide down towards turn number one. 20 car there, just almost thinking about moving down to the inside of that number 20 machine of Bronson Stafford, trying to make the pass, not able to do so, but that has got them all single fired out. Once again, this is exactly what Van Larsen would have wanted. We are back to Green Flag Racing, and Rachel, well, we've fielded a little bit more spread out now, a couple of drivers out of this race, but very close out on that restart.
It is indeed, of course, 10 cars left in the lead lap right now, and you know, the last car there is Nick Lacomi, who fighting still in the lead lap, did just that. So right now, it's going to be, well, lucky for him, because he's now back in his fight if he can get through 10 cars. But as we said, Van Larsen getting away to front, but being hounded by that 32 of Borges, who did qualify well. He was P5, let's not forget, as was Bronson Stafford as well. Both mired by traffic. They're in this fight. This could be a close one.
Yeah, we're down to 52 laps to go here then at Bristol Motor Speedway. There you can see Van Larsen as Borges right behind them. Let's then ride along board with that number 32 car as he heads himself down towards the back straightaway, down immediately leading towards turn number 3 and 4. You see once again, Rachel, they're running that Darlington line. Borges can get close, but not quite close enough to slot that car to the inside. The question will be, does he try and make the move early, or does he try and just sit there, try not to use his tyres too hard, keep in contact and see what he can do in about 15-20 lap time?
Well, that'll be it then. Once the tyres start to go off, that's when you can really make those moves. But further back in the pack, the LSRTV 13 is fighting that Reams 18, and the eBay Motor 17 has just gone into the wall there. That was really close back in the pack. Those cars fighting very eagerly for position.
Yeah, Mike Teller there in the number 97 car. James Silvers is one of those drivers. And the number 18 machine is just behind him with CF in possession. And Nate Lamorque is still once again on this lead lap. Michael Thompson, you can see, he was actually battling it out with that LSRTV car. Number 16 and number 17 cars scrapping out for positions. They are battling for their own position, although they are scored down one lap, if that makes any sense at all. Number 16 car, Michael Thompson, they can see him right along board. And just ahead of him is the number 17 machine. That is Levi Zielinski in the Club Michigan eBay Motors car, as they work themselves along the banking once again. And Leighton Morke is going to get himself past the number 16 car. No, he won't. They'll stay in line for the time being. As we're now into lap number 154, battle for the race lead continues though, Rachel, between Ryan Borges and Michael Van Larsen.
It is indeed, and I'm trying to work out the lines these two are running right now. Van Larsen is running a pretty regular middle of the groove sort of line. It's a little faster but harder on the tyres. That 32 is diamonding a little bit. He's not right now, of course. He's following Van Larsen, trying to get closer so he can use that move, but he's going to have to try something to make this different, of course. There are two distinct lines here, Will. You can, of course, just run the top line or the top and middle. But another good one is to diamond. You go in low, you go up high, and point it back out low again. Very fast, but only really useful in clean air. And these two are trying to find anything they can to get away from each other or pass.
Yeah, and that diamonding effect also uses those tyres up just a little bit more. Just the fact that you're moving that car around the racetrack, having to crank that wheel a little bit more through the centre of the corner. But, well, these two drivers have pulled away, even though the fact they're fighting for position, Rachel. They've now got themselves a 1.4 second advantage to that number 20 car of Bronson Stafford. In fact, they gap up to 1.5 seconds, and behind them, actually, they are starting to get themselves nice little gaps going along the racetrack.
Yeah, they do indeed, and that's, of course, a big advantage until we start getting lap traffic once again. And, well, the panic factor will set in once more. Drivers wanting to stay on that lead lap, and once again, cautions breed cautions, but nothing breeds cautions like the leader trying to pass you.
Yep, as the gap between P5 and P6, 1.2 seconds. Actually going to go check back in with the Z01 car. So let's see, he's actually running in clean air, Rachel. And if Nate Lamoke, Lacome, is running himself in clean air, then we know that we might not get ourselves a caution for a few laps.
Well, that's one way of putting it. It's certainly interesting. And, well, the 25, they're getting out of the way to let the leaders through. As this carries on, I think Byrnes still, yep, he is back on track after repairs to the garage. That's 98. I'm making it up. So he's going down a lap already, and we now have 9 cars on the lead lap.
If we'd stay green, this race would be complete in about 10 minutes time. That is how fast the laps tick off here at Bristol Motor Speedway, Rachel. Up to lap 163 already. Your gap between the top two drivers. Last time by, identical lap times were within 1/1000th of a second.
Indeed, and that's going to happen here at Bristol. You can be so close, you've got, well, practically on the same time, and it will happen. But the 20 car there, P3, getting past that 98 truck, and he will carry on up this road. He's going to be trying to get back up to leaders, but they really have checked out from him right now.
Yeah, as we continue to ride along board then with Ryan Borges as they head themselves back to complete lap number 164. And we are joined, Rachel, by Corey Belvins.
Yeah, in fact, I'm here. I was about to say before Will tried to pronounce your name.
Yeah.
Here with the owner of 24 Designs and that 24 truck, Corey Blevins. Wow, it's been a tough race for you so far tonight, and well, involved in some interesting moments and some questionable on-track action. But how's it been for you?
I've got plenty of damage, so probably if I get back out there, it might be 20 laps or so. But I mean, it's Bristol, so what do you expect out of that?
Indeed, and we know you had some interesting interactions with the 01 car of, that is, of course, Nate Lacomi. Little disagreement on track, I believe?
Yeah, a little bit. He's caused me some issues in the past, so I kind of expected
sounds
it.
Sounds like
so.
A rivalry. Can you tell us more?
Yeah, more like a rivalry than anything.
Well, I was hoping for a little more juicy details, but we'll have to stick with
just
that.
Just call him Joey Logano so and be over and done with.
Indeed. But Corey, plans to get back on the racetrack, or do you think you're pretty much done for the night?
I might run a couple of laps just if someone ends up passing me or whatever, but Ryan's looking pretty good up there.
Well, you certainly will probably be winning that shortest wheelbase truck award tonight, but plans for the rest of the season?
Basically, finish the season and hope to get top five in the points.
Well, excellent. That's Corey Blevins of the number 24 Chevrolet. Thanks for your time, Corey.
Thanks. And I want to mention 24-designs.com. It's my website. You can get logos and paint schemes.
Oh, we will be sure to send people to check that out. So thank you, Corey.
Thank you.
Yep, as out front, the gap between Fenlarsson and Borges, that has just moved itself up to about 6/10 of a second. Down to less than 30 laps to go now, Rachel. And, well, we've got ourselves still a battle out front, but the gap's seeking itself out a little bit, and Borges in that dirty air just starting to fade.
He is. He's trying so hard to keep up there with Fenlarsson. I think Fenlarsson has the easier deal. He has the clean air, but he might just be, looking at his line, he seems a little less aggressive on the corners. So he's saving a bit of tyres there, and that's a real advantage to him as this run goes on. And should this stay green, I think that gap will open up again. We saw he was great in the long run earlier on, when we actually got a long run. It really showed through. So, kind of hoping that can go with this one. Car spinning to the infield there to let the leader pass. I'm not sure that's how he wanted it to go, but that is Levi Zeleninski, who's just backwards in that eBay Motor 17 truck.
Yep, let's get ourselves another look at that one then. We're running on board of him as well. That driver is probably going to stay there, otherwise he'll bring out a caution. But we're having a look at him there.
Michigan car
and 01 car. What a surprise. Yep. There we can see him down, spinning around as Zelinski there doesn't bring the caution out initially. Unless I'm very much mistaken, Rachel, we are still green.
We are indeed.
So, very good there for Zelinski to be careful when he gets himself back onto the racetrack. We are down to less than 25 laps to go. And just before we went on air, Rachel, I said 1 hour 27 minutes for this race. I'm actually still in the chance of getting that right.
So what exactly number are we on right now, Will? 1 hour 10?
I'm trying to work it out, and I think we're on 1 hour 11.
It's going to be close. Of course, before the race, this being Bristol, myself and Will had a little, what should we say, a friend's bet of how long it would take. Of course, green flag racing wise, we're looking at just about an hour's racing, and Will decided he wanted to go under 1 minute 27, I said over 1 minute 27, 1 hour 27, I apologise. It wouldn't be 1 minute 27 unless it was one lap, but yeah, so I voted over, Will said under, Anybody on the comments on YouTube, if you have an opinion, of course. We've had quite a few cautions so far. Will this stay green to the end? We have 20 laps to go. What will be the end?
Well, we've got the 0-1 car battling it out with Evan Prosecco. And what, late, Nakome has had himself a bit of a reputation this race, running himself down in P9, of course, getting himself pole position for this event, up on the rear of that number 13 LSR TV car as they head themselves off the banking, then down the back straightaway into woods, corner number 3 and 4. And Nakome actually pushing up a little bit high that time by less than 20 laps to go. Getting himself a very good run off the corner, actually, though. And this is the thing for Nakome. He gets himself very good runs, and then he just tries to slot that car down to the inside. He's doing that on Evan Prosecco right now. If you are that number 13 car, you might think, I don't want to keep my car in one piece, Rachel.
Yeah, exactly. And well, I think we'll give him a little bit of room, although he's about to go
a
lap
down.
Oh! 13!
And that's your leader there! Your leader just tagging the rear of that 0-1 car. We talked about it, we alluded to it, and well, Rachel, there are times when sometimes we just get ourselves a little bit too excited. That is what happened there. We do, however, as far as I can see, stay green. 15 laps to go. How we are still green, I have no idea. Evan Prosecco is still running in that number 13 car. He did make contact. Somehow he will stay going. This track is self-cleaning, Rachel. So sometimes if the cars get off the track at a certain rate of speed, they do avoid bringing the caution out. But what this has done is it's put Borges back into it because, well, Fenn Larsen's got himself a little bit of damage now on that car. Borges can potentially start smelling himself the opportunity to get to victory lane here.
He might, but I don't know if it's possible. There isn't that much damage on the 28 car truck even. Sorry, of course, these are trucks. But it's going to be an interesting fight. The 32 smells blood, but I just don't know if he can make it past. If he tries too hard now, the tyres will be gone. And as we said earlier, that 0-1 truck is getting a reputation as a bit of a Kyle Busch right now. Well, a Kyle Busch of his early years, I should say. As, yep, everything but the pace car has been hit this race.
In fact,
got several things twice.
Yeah, I actually do think he did actually hit the pace car initially at some point as well.
He must have done, yeah. It's possible.
But here is your battle then. We're going to have 11 laps to go. Caution is out then. And that's the reason why number 20 car are Bronson Stafford involved in the number 20 machine. So we are going to have ourselves somewhere in the region of a 5-lap shootout here at Bristol Motor Speedway, Rach.
We are indeed, and that was the 20 car on the outside there, that 98 truck who's a lap down, coming down a little across the 98's nose and, well, getting himself spun out. That's going to happen when you do that, guys.
Yeah, and Stafford there, well, he started off by just tagging the outside safety barrier, then gets tagged around on the exit of the corner, came down a little bit too early. Number 20 car is classified as out of the race. Here's the big question. Well, it's already being answered for us, really, Rachel. Do you come onto pit road or do you stay on the racetrack with 5 laps
oh,
to
hell
go?
Yes.
You, of course,
oh, hell
you
yes.
come down. And Fenn Larsen, actually, no, Fenn Larsen is staying on the oh. racetrack. Borges is on pit road. So Borges here gambling on and other drivers coming in. You've got yourself Silvers on pit road. You've got yourself Tello on pit road. So basically, Fenn Larsen might have just thrown this race away. He is going to have to hope for the start of a lifetime here. But actually, got Bronson Stafford staying out as well. So Fenn Larsen, Stafford both staying out. Everyone else coming to pit road. Your front row is going to be on old tyres, Rachel. Everyone behind is going to be on new tyres. Here's what Fenn Larsen and Stafford are hoping for. Someone in that pack to try and jump the start, because that will mean that this race will finish under caution.
It is, and we have a mixed fuel strategy here, or mixed tyre strategy, I should say, which is going to make this very interesting. Of course, we had green-white checker racing in the first 10 laps here of 200 at Bristol Motor Speedway, and, if they race like that at the start of the race, how are they going to race like that in the last 5? And with mixed tyres, this is going to be, I think, a caution will end this race well.
I agree.
Put money on that now.
I completely agree. We've got ourselves less than 10 laps to go here at Bristol Motor Speedway, ladies and gentlemen. We'll be back for the restart in just one moment's time. We'll take you RaceSpot TV side by side.
has officially begun.
There's your race leader. It's Michael Fenlarsen. Himself and Brunson Stafford have stayed out for what will be the final caution, well, final restart of the day, shall we say. The next flag will end this race, essentially. If we go green to the end, we'll see the white flag. If we get ourselves a caution from here on in, we will have ourselves pretty much a race in the books. Unless the lap gods allow us to have one more restart. We shouldn't do though. 28 car on the outside line. Ready for the restart here. Bristol Motor Speedway. Green flag back in the air. And this is where these two drivers out front are going to have to hope and pray. Number 20 car though. Of Brunson Stafford. Looking down to the inside through turn number one. We've got ourselves a little bit of contact further back. But we all stay green for the time being. And it's Fenlarsen who leads right now from Borges. On the exit of turn number three and four. There will be a turn number five laps to go this time by. And somehow Borges now right on the outside. He's going to go to the outside through turn number two. Rachel, this is a pass on the race lead, and Fenlarsen getting loose. Fenlarsen turning around there. Fenlarsen into the wall. Big contact behind. We stay green somehow. No, we won't. This will be the caution. This will be the race. Borges is your winner.
Well, that was interesting.
I think what happened, Michael Fenlarsen just got himself all forms of loose as that car looked to the outside of him. Let's have a look at this one. On board of him then. You'll notice that a car on the outside will come to him right about now. As you can see there, that is the car just working himself on the outside. At that point, on the inside line, let's not forget, Rachel, Fenlarsen's on old tyres. He's not been down on that inside line pretty much all race long. And I think that car just got a little bit loose on him. From then on, game over.
Well, it was certainly a racing thing, but like most racing incidents in Bristol, they start about half a lap back and usually continue for another lap afterwards. So, that's it. This is ending the race. I believe Ryan Borges will win in that number 32 truck. And, he's been fighting through the whole day. He's been at the front and the back. And that racer boost, number 32 Toyota Tundra, will be heading to victory lane.
Yep, we can see that number 32 car then. And as it stands, unless anyone's stupid enough to come on towards pit road, this is your top eight drivers. It's Borges from Silvers, from Kuninski, from Stafford, Thurin, Teller, Lacome, and Fenlarsen. Fenlarsen will be down in P number eight as well. We've got ourselves about a mile remaining of this event. Running along board then with the driver of Ryan Borges in the Club New England number 32 car as he heads himself back down the back straightaway. And in just one moment's time, we'll get ourselves the yellow and the white flag out here in the 24designs.com night race at Bristol Motor Speedway in memory of Steve Byrnes. And Ryan Borges now just going to be half a mile behind the Ison.com first safety car at exactly 60 miles an hour, which means if you want to do some quick and simple math, 30 seconds until Ryan Borges is a winner here today, as he's just going to cross that start finish line. Now the white and the yellow flag are out, so this is the last lap of tonight's event. As we can see then, we'll put that bottom top eight back on your screen. That is how it will finish in your top eight. We have ourselves just eight drivers finishing on the lead lap. So these are all the drivers who finish themselves on the lead lap. Evan Prosecco in P number 9 will be classified as one lap down. Dalton Alexander will round out your top 10. But Ryan Borges here today led himself 47 laps. Michael Fenlarsen led himself almost half of today's race. But there's four laps at the very end he didn't lead. Otherwise, he would have led exactly half of the race. Unfortunately, those four laps, we saw him getting turned around after getting loose on the exit of corner number two. And it will mean that Ryan Borges will be claiming victory here in the 24designs.com night race at Bristol Motor Speedway in memory of Steve Byrnes. Borges, that's right, is your winner. Then you've got yourself, the rest of your field doing what they do best here at Bristol Motor Speedway. Just getting themselves a little bit of contact, a little bit of beating, a little bit of banging. But Rachel, important thing is Ryan Borges is your winner.
Yes, indeed, and well, he's earned it by surviving this one. And well, we had eight cars left on the lead lap, and well, last lap passed for the win, even though it was under caution. But it was never going to end under green, was it, Will?
Well, No comment. Bristol, let's be honest, no matter what you do at Bristol, to get a green white checkered situation never really is going to work. Let's run you through then your final race results here from tonight's event. Well, Ryan Borges then in the Club New England car coming home in first place. Under caution, James Silvers in second, Justin Krinsky in third, Bronson Stafford in fourth, Shane Thurin in fifth, Mike Teller sixth, Nate Lacombe in seventh, Michael Fenlassen in eighth, Evan Prosecco in ninth, and then Dalton Alexander running out your top 10, a total of 8 drivers finishing out of the 19 that started on the lead lap here today, with Michael Thompson in 11th, Jason Thompson in 12th, Levi Zielinski in 13th, John Deacon, Clint Carr running out your top 15, and Corey Belvin, Steve Bonesteel, Rome Kruska, and Cody Tabor classified as out of the race. We'll be back after this message. You're watching RaceSpot TV. Welcome back to RaceSpot TV, ladies and gentlemen. Don't forget, we are in the month of May. If you're a fan of IndyCar racing, don't forget the Angie's List Indianapolis Grand Prix taking place this weekend. You can catch that one on ABC. Watch ESPN and the ESPN player in Europe as we build ourselves up to the 99th running of the Indianapolis 500. Here on iRacing, we've got ourselves two rounds of the iRacing.com World Championship Grand Prix Series. First off, we head ourselves to Hootown as we will move ourselves to Watkins Glen International, a track that Gregor Hootoo has never lost at in World Championship competition. And then we've got ourselves Virginia International Raceway on Memorial Day weekend. And of course, don't forget, we've got ourselves the sixth running of the iRacing.com Indianapolis 500. Catch that one on iRacing Live, RaceSpot TV, PSR TV. More details on that one is coming soon. Well, here today then, it was Ryan Borges who was able to hold on at the end, getting himself the pass to the win with just 5 laps to go. And for a moment, Ryan, you must have thought that race was flashing across your eyes, because at the point that you went at yourself on the outside, you had yourself that moment where the former race leader just got himself a little bit loose, Michael Fenlassen, almost coming across you into your car, you able to hold on, claim victory under caution here today at Bristol Motor Speedway.
Oh yeah, that was crazy there at the end. I started off the race pretty quick. I was able to keep it up front and take the lead for the first half of the race or so, but after that I just got shuffled back and it was just a catch-up game, and it's so hard to pass at Bristol, so it took me almost that whole entire second half of the race just to get up to the lead. And I thought Michael had the race. If we went green there, I was just having a tough time even getting to his bumper, but with that caution, obviously all different strategies played out. And I just knew from experience if we were going to get 3 or 4 or more laps than that, tires were going to be more beneficial than staying out. So luckily, only 2 guys stayed out, so I got a good jump on that restart and was able to just dart to the outside and just past Michael. I got clipped by him and was able to hold on, and luckily I got the win there.
Well, you got yourself victory. Taking those tires, did you think that you were going to be the people, the one person, the two people even coming onto pit road? Were you hoping that everyone was going to come back? And how difficult was it having two drivers to pass compared to just the lone duck of Michael Fenlassen out front?
Oh, it was definitely more challenging than just having the leader stay out, because I was on the inside there, and it was definitely an outside groove track, so I really had to make sure I was going to get clear of fourth place there, and also hope that a Bronson in front of me was going to get a good start and then also pass him. So I was hoping I would at least get a decent finish there. I wasn't expecting to pass for the win, but the hole just opened up, so I darted to the outside of Bronson right at the exit of the corner and was able to just take the outside there and get up to Michael and pass him. I mean, on those old tires, after a long run like that, you don't have the speed and you don't have the speed at all, really.
Then you made yourself a pass. You got yourself to iRacing.com victory lane here on the 24designs.com night race at Bristol Motor Speedway in memory of Steve Byrnes. Give the opportunity to give yourself a couple of shout outs to your friends, sponsors, etc., etc.
Oh, I definitely got to thank 24designs and Checker Flag Racing League for putting this race on. It was a blast to run. It's definitely for a good cause in memory of Steve Byrnes. He was a great iRacing announcer. I'm not iRacing announcer, a NASCAR announcer, and a lot of people miss him, so this is a memory of him. And I also got to thank sponsors on the truck. I got to thank Racer Boost, the Extreme Racing Series, Molecule. I've got to thank Jerky XP, Storm Motorsports, and then Corey Blevins for painting up the truck today for the race, and for also sponsoring the race. And I got to thank you guys for putting it on. It was definitely a blast.
No worries. Ryan Borges there claiming himself race victory here today. Rachel Whiteford is stood by with a number 13 machine. Off you go.
I am indeed. I'm here with Evan Pasoko. I'm sorry if I butchered your name.
That was right on.
Evan Pasoko. There we go. I've got it right. You came in the ninth position. You started P10, of course, so you made a net gain of one. Finished race a lap down, though, and it was pretty eventful for you, though. You've been up and down that field. How was it for you?
Yeah, if we were anywhere but Bristol, I'd say, it was a ninth place truck and I'd be happy with it. But I think we got up to fourth at one point, and it was Bristol. There was a lot going on. We got turned a couple of times. I think twice we ended up in the fence, and I had the broadcast pulled up, so I was listening in. We just kept coming down, kept getting it fixed, and got caught up in a situation there at the end right in front of Ryan and them. I was trying to get down out of the leader's way, and I was fighting for position, and I guess the guy inside me didn't get the memo. So that was almost really bad, and that got us cut a lap down. But it was fun. I don't really do a lot of league racing stuff. Hopped in here to support these guys, and the race was for a great cause also.
It was indeed. Anybody you'd like to thank on that truck? And don't worry, you can thank your title sponsor.
No, we're
yeah,
not
I gotta
allowed.
Give a shout out to LSRTV on the car as well. Corey Blevins, a good buddy of mine. I'm one of the people that we work with on Facebook for 24designs. CFI, GSRC, driversedge.org, just everybody that makes it happen. And then you guys as well for putting on the broadcast. I turned it on about halfway through, almost wrecked under caution, trying to get it pulled up. I'll make sure to go back and watch it. But from what I heard, it was exciting. So thanks to you guys. And hopefully I'll be able to maybe do some more races and not end up a lap down and kind of in the junker like we did tonight.
How confusing is it to have English people commentating on NASCAR?
It's different. I'll take it, though. Hey, because I don't race. I'm not normally on, that side of the camera. So it's kind of cool to see, yourself on the TV as opposed to the other way around.
Hey, Mom, I'm on TV.
Exactly. There you go.
Indeed. Bristol's one of those tracks, though, that's certainly it either goes very well or incredibly badly, and you pulled it out of the bag in the end, Evan, and P9, it's respectable here considering the death blender that it turned out to be. But of course, Will standing by now with the man that could have been today's race winner. Finished a position ahead of you, Evan. Will, take it away.
It's Michael Fenlassen, number 28 car. He's led himself a total of 96 laps here today. Unfortunately, Michael, the last four of them didn't really go your way, and of course, as we know, you can lead as many laps as you want in these form of racing. It's always the latter ones that make the difference.
Yeah, I was just going for it all in those last few laps. There was a lot of lap cars behind me. I didn't know if everybody pit or not. I was asking it over the radio, and I guess everybody did pit except my teammate Bronson, but he tried to hold them off on that restart. It just didn't work, and I knew Ryan was going to catch me. It was just a matter of trying to battle him, and coming off a two with on lap two of that restart, I knew he was way faster than me, and I just got really loose off the corner and couldn't control it. I was just going for it.
Well, when you had that final caution, was there any part of you thinking, you know what, I really should come into pit road right now?
Well, yeah, I was thinking of coming to pit road. We run about a 55 lap run right there, I think it was, and I was thinking of coming to pit road. I just didn't know who pit or not. I saw Ryan coming from second, and then it was too late for me, so I don't know. I just stayed out and just decided to go for it.
And at the point you went back to green, I presume you would have wanted a very quick caution. You had yourself a 3-lap green flag run before that caution finally came out. Unfortunately, you were there as part of that caution. Is there anything that you would have done differently overall? And overall, what were your overall thoughts of the race? And I said overall about 4 times in that sentence.
Yeah, that was an absolutely amazing race. I mean, the first half had a lot of yellows, but you always have that kind of racing at Bristol. The second half was a lot better for me, and I took the lead on the second half and led most of the second half, so it was a lot of fun. I didn't really know that I had that fast of a truck, and 2 hours ago, I didn't even know I'd be able to race because of my computer issues, but I got them fixed, and I was able to race. But if I was able to do something different, I probably would have been on that last yellow. Everybody could say that.
Hindsight 2020. Michael Fenlassen coming home in that 28 car then. Before we let you go, time to give a shout-out to anyone you want to give a shout-out to.
Oh, yeah, I'd like to give a shout-out to everybody that came tonight, and it was a lot of fun. And shout-out to you guys for broadcasting this race. We'll definitely consider you guys in the new broadcast and soon in the future. And Fastenal for jumping on board this truck all season.
Fastenal there, of course, on that number 28 car. Michael Fenlassen coming home in P number 8. And, well, Rachel, we leave Bristol Motor Speedway, but one thing that we won't do is ever forget the contribution to NASCAR that Steve Byrnes has played to many, many fans around the world. Of course, we talk about the work that he did on Fox NASCAR 2001 through 2014, but you've got to go back further than that to actually fully understand the contribution that Steve made to, well, America's greatest motorsport.
It was indeed, and, Steve Byrnes is a name synonymous with NASCAR racing in America, and he'll be missed. I don't think it could ever be the same without him. He's one of those faces and one of those voices that simply has personified the sport. And like I said earlier, our thoughts and prayers with his family and friends at this time. It's a tragic fight he's lost to cancer, and one that many, many other people around the world are dealing with now. The loss of loved ones and loved ones going through the process. So our thoughts and prayers to them as well.
Well, and on that note, ladies and gentlemen, we shall leave it here today. This has been a RaceSpot TV presentation of the 24designs.com night race at Bristol Motor Speedway in memory of Steve Byrnes, presented by the Checkered Flag Racing League. Myself, Will Vinson, from Rachel Whiteford. We shall talk to you all next time. Bye-bye.